That's on Facebook at Spirit FM Radio WAFG.
And we're back already. I have the wrong CD, Pastor Ron. You left me anyway. Just we're back, and that's a short break. And man, I just love to be here each week talking about Jesus because we see the insight and the wisdom. Only insight can be found by coming at the feet of Jesus, really, to understand his word as we study the scriptures. He gives us wisdom and insight. He had told them in several places that he's going to die. They didn't hear it. They didn't listen. Their minds were in other places. Here is someone who Jesus had healed, Jesus had comfort, and she trusts in who he is because he has shown her the love for him, his love for her, and she's reciprocating on that by loving him as well. So the oil's important. Oil formed a unique bond between Jesus, Mary, here particularly. The scent remained on Jesus days after, perhaps after the cross, and imagine the comfort it brought. The scent remained on Mary for days and also shared in the same fragrance in the whole household. And he says in verse 13, as you said, Pastor Bill, surely I say to you, two prophecies here. Wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, the first prophecy, the church is a global influence. What this woman has done will also be told as a memorial to her. The second prophecy, Mary's memorial. And again, 2019, we are studying this scripture, and we're learning from Mary. We want to give Jesus our all. We want to be at the feet of Jesus, studying his scriptures, learning from him, trusting in the words that he said.
I just can't even imagine the other guys when they hear Jesus say, what this woman has done will be told throughout the whole world and everything. I think they're saying, are you going to tell them what we said too? Because that's a little embarrassing if you keep telling them what we said. But it's a good way to consider your own life because, you know, there's our deeds are kind of written, you know, eternally out as our legacy. And if we want to not be ashamed, you know, in that day that everything's examined, we should consider how we're living, you know, each and every day and each and every hour.
And you know what, Pastor Bill, sometimes the Lord does know how to put us in our spot,
amen.
You know, just like he did with these guys. But it also shows me here, you know what this lady did, it was serious. It was powerful. You know, it's a testimony for her 2,000 years later. So even the things that we do, Pastor Bill, Pastor Ken, they're not insignificant for the kingdom of God. Even if you're handing someone a cup of water that's thirsty, it's just as vital, just as important of what this lady did too. You're doing it for the Lord. Whether you're visiting someone in a jail cell or visiting someone in a hospital or handing someone a sandwich who's hungry, it's just as valuable, Pastor Ken, I believe, at what this lady's doing and what she did for Christ. What we do for the Lord, we are storing up those treasures in heaven for eternity. You shared that illustration today, Pastor Ken, with the rope and the little, you know, red area of the rope is so insignificant compared to eternity.
Sure.
So the things that we do for Christ is for eternity. You know, these guys, again, they're wrestling and what she's doing. But here this lady is storing up something not only for, you know, today in this world, in this earth, we're sharing it 2,000 later, but that was also with eternal value for her in her eternity, you know, Pastor Ken, in her rewards. That's right. And it's really awesome to see that she believed what the Lord was saying.
So sometimes we want to ask, you know, well, how do we not make the mistake of the apostles, and how do we get into that right standing with Christ the way this woman seemed to do? And the difference I see between the apostles and this woman here is simply they're being led by their head. Hey, this is a monetary thing. It's being poured out. It could have been sold to the poor. You know, it's all calculated stuff. She's being led by her heart. And God is always targeting our heart. I know in 1 Corinthians it talks about the wisdom of this world, or the wisdom of God is, the foolishness of God is wiser than the wisdom of the world. You know, God is not giving us IQ tests to see who can go to heaven and things like that. Thank God for Ken, right?
He's me out, right? Nobody's washing my feet and I can't get there myself.
You always got to pick on the top dog, you know. So, but it's a heart test. Everything's a heart test. And you know, I think I've said it before a couple weeks ago, but, you know, I love the Magi's question to Herod when they say, where is he who's been born king of the Jews? And then there's no direct answer given. until you see that direct answer all the way in Matthew 27, Jesus beaten and bloodied, hanging on a cross, sign over his head gives the answer. This is Jesus, the King of the Jews.
Yeah.
And why does it wait till that moment? I believe it's because God wants you to look at the beaten and bloodied body of Jesus Christ and say, do you see a king there or not? Only your heart could see a king, not your head. Your head would say, that is a victim, that is a poor, homeless peasant being executed for crimes against the government.
Wow.
Your heart would say, that's a king who's not ordering other people to die for him. That's a king who's actually dying for me. And that's why he has my devotion.
That's interesting, because I'm sure you guys have watched The Passion of the Christ. And I remember when the first time I watched it, I was in Hollywood. And when I walked out of there, you know, after that movie, I looked up and I'm like, how in the world can you do that for me? You know, you talk about a head wrestle. You know, I felt in here because I was choking up and tearing up, but I also wrestled. Like, it doesn't make any sense, Pastor Ken. Why would you go through what you did, you know, for someone like me? And again, if you know, to the listeners, if you question or doubt the Lord's love for you, and we all do, even as believers sometimes, because I still don't get it. Like, why would you do that? Is just look into what he did. Look to the cross. Believe like Mary. You talk about childlike faith. This lady was in his presence. You know, like the Bible says, in his presence is fullness of joy. There was something about being next to him that impacted this woman's life. You know, we can learn from her to be humble, get our minds out of the way, read the Word of God, do what it says, apply it, and see and watch. Like the Bible says, taste and see that the Lord is good. And when you really experience that forgiveness, and I know you shared the verse, Pastor Bill, you know, he who is forgiven of much will love much. I love that, because I understood for what I was forgiven of was much. So when you're forgiven of much, it's a lot easier to love someone who would forgive you of such a great debt, Pastor Ken.
You know, isn't it astounding that as we have a habit of questioning God's love for us?
It's amazing.
Isn't it astounding that if God said, ask me to do anything to prove my love for you, you can ask whatever you want so that you'll never ever doubt again. Isn't it amazing that we could look at God and say, if you love me so much, kill your kid. And God would look at us and say, done, so that you'll never doubt again. What more could you challenge God to do to prove his love for you? And that is exactly what he has done.
Of course, and that is not easy, because, you know, I wouldn't die for you, Pastor Bill. I like you, but I don't like you that much. You know, and to see him, and we're all dads here, who's willing to give up their child for somebody else? I'm certainly not ready to do that, Pastor Ken.
Yeah.
You know, and to see, for God so loved the world that he gave his son. There's that sacrifice. There's that lamb. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. We might not get it. We might not understand it. It does take faith. But believe it, he loves us, and it's amazing.
Yeah, and he doesn't tell us we have to die. He says to live for him, right? We die to self, we're born again, but we live for Christ. And here we see the fulfillment of what Jesus has just said. Fulfilled because Matthew, Mark, and John have preserved this, as you've mentioned, Pastor Bill. Mary gave this gift about a year's wages. Mary receives an enduring legacy of honor, and Jesus always gives us back more than we give him. And so here, exactly what he said would happened. Now, verse 14 through 16, then on the one of the 12 called Judas Iscariot went to the chief priests and said, what are you willing to give me if I deliver him to you? And they counted out him 30 pieces of silver. So from that time, he sought the opportunity to betray him. This is an amazing scene. They go from a house gathering together. Well, we love you, Jesus. Now he's going to betray Jesus.
Yeah. And just this juxtaposition of her pouring out a year's wages of oil on his head. And the first thing out of Judas's mouth is, what will you give me?
Yeah.
So it's just this overwhelming sense of self. And greed and so forth that we're seeing here. And if I'm not mistaken, and Ken, I think you might have said this before, but 30 pieces was the price for a slave.
Yeah.
Correct? So
Exodus chapter 21, 30 silver pieces was the price for a wounded slave, actually.
Wow. So you did that out of memory. That was awesome.
I did.
So, so I mean, just again, just these people walking in the perfect narrative of God's sovereignty. I mean, it's not 29 pieces. It's not 31 pieces. It's not more or less. It's the exact price of a servant. And here you have the King of Glory who pronounces himself as a servant. And that's the exact price. He's not even there for the transaction yet. And ends up being the price of his own identity that he tells us he has.
Well, consider this. Exodus 21, 32. 30 silver pieces was the price for a wounded slave. Isaiah 53, 5. Jesus was a servant wounded for our transgressions. God has worked out everything to his perfect plan. And we need to look at the contrast between Mary and Judas. Judas had been with Jesus a significant time. Mary comes at a later time. She is a picture of two categories of people, one who is selfless, and we see Judas who is selfish. Christianity, what can Jesus do for me today? And hopefully that's not our hearts. Hopefully it's looking to Christ at what he has done for us, and then we give him our all. And so Judas's price reveals the value, this is key, the value of the relationship with Jesus. A low price tag. What are you going to give me for this guy, right? Here, on one hand, Mary gives what is most valuable to her, all she had of value, at Jesus' feet. We see the opposite effect of Judas.
Yeah, and how do we value Jesus Christ? I mean, what are we willing to give, as you asked? And you know, the Bible asks for nothing less than your entire life. I mean, I think of Paul's words in Galatians 2:20, you know, I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but it's Christ who lives through me. And just as Mary's not missing the money that she just poured all over the head of Jesus Christ, we don't miss that life that was crucified. You know, we get this newness of life that we've never known before. And we begin literally our eternal life, the moment of our conversion. And there is no amount of wealth that could replace that.
You know, it's interesting, Pastor Ken, you know, I look up at the previous verses. Here you have the disciples where the kingdom of darkness, Pastor Ken, is also hearing what Jesus is saying about 2 days and I will be that Passover. So you have the kingdom of darkness almost influencing the disciples to oppose what Jesus is doing. Here you have someone led by the Holy Spirit, this beautiful woman, agreeing with what the Lord is saying. And I'm convinced that these guys don't fully understand, because remember, Jesus said, in how many days? In 2 days. So I could just see how the kingdom of darkness is going to try to oppose. Here comes Judas, you know, with his schemes, a plot and plan, what he's going to do, sell them out, trying to thwart maybe that plan of what Jesus said. If I could just get him off track, these guys can come in, take him, you know, totally get rid of what he's going to do and what he's prophesying about. Let's mess up and just contradict what he just said about 2 days. You know, it's very interesting to see how here comes Judas, the enemy, the lover of money. I get what that says. But being that puppet for the dark side to thwart God's plan. And you see that from the beginning, always trying to get in there and stop what Jesus is saying. And trying to not to bring, you know, stop it from coming to pass.
Yeah, there's an old saying that says, still as of old, men by themselves are priced for 30 silver pieces. Judas sold himself, not Christ. That's his value of what he, because Jesus was the life. You know, he sold his damnation for 30 pieces of silver. And that was what he valued. You know, it's interesting today, as we look at Scripture, Jesus says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter into my kingdom. And the response of those he says that to are, well, didn't we do all these things in your name? And he says, depart from me. I never knew you. And it's important to understand it's not the things that we do. It's the things that he did. And it's that relationship between the doing and the knowing. The knowing Christ is the head knowledge. It is receiving the gift of eternal life by a surrendered life to Christ to understand that. And then after that, the true works of service to Christ come, the serving as we're doing now. This is a result of the Lord transforming and changing my life from a heathen to a Christian believer. And am I perfect now? No. Am I who I was? Absolutely not. And I'm on my way. And all of us are in the same boat. But the what price do we put on Christ? Is he most important in our life, and our actions dictate that? So we're going to take another break. Hopefully I got the right disc in. Stand by. We'll be right back.
Listening to the new Spirit FM music.
Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been saved.
In ministry.
Jesus says in John chapter 14, 16, he will never leave us. He will never leave us. Deuteronomy 31, 6, he will never leave you or forsake you. Deuteronomy 31, 8, do not be afraid.
WAFG LP, Pompano Beach, Spirit FM.
If you're talking, they will hear you.
Why are we getting killed like this?
Kyle's not here. Got caught drinking beer in the park a couple of nights ago.